بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته أبنائي الطلبة الأعزاء. We shall start together explaining the subject of blood groups. We mentioned it before in lecture, but we mentioned it rapidly, so I shall mention them again rapidly. As we know that according to Landsteiner law, he discovered two genes on the outer surface of the red blood cells. One is called A antigen and the other is B antigen, and we called them agglutinogens. So we have two agglutinogens are around on the outer surface of the red blood cells, either to be A or B, and they were found for the first time by Landsteiner. And Landsteiner mentioned a law about these two antigens. He told us that if a particular agglutinogen is present on the outer surface of the red blood cell, so no antibodies will be around in the serum of this blood group, because actually the two antigens have also in the plasma, the two antigens around on the outer surface of the red blood cells have a corresponding antibodies on the plasma, but these antibodies are called agglutinins, and we have either alpha or beta agglutinin. So alpha agglutinin is corresponding to A antigen, and beta agglutinin is corresponding to B antigen. According to Landsteiner law, so if a particular agglutinogen is present on the outer surface of the red blood cell, the corresponding agglutinin must be absent in the serum. So for example, if you have blood group A, so the agglutinogen on the outer surface of the red blood cell is A, so the plasma of this man having blood group A never to contain alpha agglutinin, but beta agglutinin can be present without any problems and no reaction will happen. So also the second law, if the Landsteiner informed us that there is a particular agglutinogen is absent on the red blood cell, so the corresponding agglutinin must be present without in the serum without any problems. In such condition, the blood groups are classified mainly according to the ABO system to four groups, but we have naturally more than 20 genetically groups systems are known nowadays. Not only the ABO system is one of them, and according to and it is the most famous blood grouping system. And this system actually, depending on this system, we classified the blood into four groups based on the presence or absence of agglutinogens A and B. So we have the first group is group A. So in the outer surface of the cell membrane of the red blood cell, we have agglutinogen A, while in the serum we have beta agglutinin. So no problem and no reaction can happen in such condition. And similarly, when we have blood group B, so in the outer surface of the cell membrane there is agglutinogen B, while in the plasma or in the serum there is agglutinin alpha. So no problem in such condition. So the third group is AB. So in such condition, we have both antigens are around on the outer surface of the red blood cell, both A and B antigen agglutinogens. So serum must not contain any agglutinins in such condition, and actually in blood group AB the serum does not contain any agglutinins. The fourth group is group O. Group O or group 0, meaning that There is no agglutinogens on the outer surface of the red blood cells, while the serum contains both agglutinins. Alpha and beta agglutinins are present in the serum of blood group O. So what is the incidence of this blood group? What is the most common blood group around in population? Actually, blood group O is the most common one. It is about 45%, followed by group A, which is around 40%, followed by group B, which is about 10%, and the most rare blood group is AB group, which is 5% of population. According to this ABO system, actually we had a blood group which is called universal donor, because in blood transfusion from blood from an individual to another individual, so what is most important in blood transfusion, it is the agglutinogen of the donor and the agglutinin of the recipient. So in such condition, we have agglutinogen of the donor which can react with the agglutinin of the recipient. Of the corresponding agglutinin is around in the blood of the recipient. In such condition, agglutination and clumping of red blood cells can occur. So if we have a blood group having no antigens on the outer surface of the red blood cell, so in such condition, there is no, if the donor having this group, it can be transfused, his blood can be transfused to any other blood group, because actually the antigens on this group are absent, and the antibody of recipient will never react with something which is not around. Who is the blood group which is not having antigen on the outer surface of the cell membrane? It is group O. But actually, because we discovered other antigen systems other than the ABO system, so this universal donor, what the considering blood group O to be a universal donor, is now obsolete. Also, so we have another blood group which can we can consider it as universal recipient, which can receive blood from any other blood groups. So this blood group must not contain any agglutinins. If we have a blood group which can receive blood from any other groups, it is this recipient group must not contain any agglutinins. What is that blood group which is not containing any agglutinins? It is AB group. It contains both AB agglutinogens, but the serum is not containing any agglutinin. So this AB group can receive blood from any other from A blood group or B blood group or O blood group without any problems, actually, because serum, because the serum of this AB blood group is not containing any agglutinins. But because there is also, as we mentioned before, with the universal donor, there is many agglutinogen systems other than the ABO system, so now the universal recipient also is obsolete, and we cannot depend on these rules during a blood transfusion. About the inheritance of ABO agglutinogens, so these agglutinogens are mucopolysaccharides, and they appear during the fetal life in the 6 months of pregnancy. Their concentration at birth is around 20%, and it increases gradually till rises to the adult level at puberty. The antigens, these antigens, AB antigens, are also present on other cells like white blood cells, platelets, epidermal cells, endothelial cells, salivary glands, pancreas, salivary secretion, kidney, liver, and lungs, and so and of other as well. So AB glutenogens are present on the red blood cells and present on the cells of other tissues of the same individual. blood group, so blood group to call it A or B, so this depend upon the two genes, either gene A or gene B, which are dominant genes by themselves, or they are dominant genes. But gene O is recessive, so the inheritance of blood groups is represented, as we shall mention later on. So in this table around in front of us now, we have blood group A. So this blood group A, either to be two dominant A gene and A gene, or to be A dominant A and recessive O. So this gene A is called allele. So this gene, the individual gene which either to be A or O in group A, in blood group A, is called allele. While the blood group A, which is consisting of two genes, is called the blood group offspring or phenotype. So if blood group which is consisting of AA or AO, so if it is consisting of A and A, both genes are A, dominant A and A, we call them homozygous genotype. But if blood group A is consisting of gene A and gene O, so we call it in such condition heterozygous genotype. And this is also mentioned in other blood groups, like for example in blood group B, either to be dominant B plus B or dominant B plus recessive O. So the phenotype is B, this is blood group B, and the genotype either to be BB or BO. The blood group, so we have two dominant genes, A and B genes, so the blood group phenotype is AB, while the homozygous, it is heterozygous A and B. Blood group also, both genes are dominant, there is no genes around, the phenotype is O, and the possibility is homozygous, but no genes are present. So in what time the agglutinins appear in the plasma? So the agglutinogens start to appear during the fetal life in the 6 months and reach maximum at puberty. So in what time the agglutinins appear? Actually, agglutinins are not produced during the fetal life, but they start to appear 2 or 3 months after birth and reach maximum within from 8 to 10 years, then decrease with the advance of age. These agglutinins of the ABO system are gamma globulin type M, immunoglobulin M. These immunoglobulin M is characterized by having large molecular weight and large molecular size, so they cannot pass through the placental barrier. These agglutinins actually are produced by plasma cells, which is a type of the white blood cells. What is the importance of ABO system? Why we are studying ABO system? Actually, we have two causes to study the ABO system. One of them is blood transfusion. So, cross-matching test by testing the donor's red blood cells with the plasma or serum of the recipient must be done before blood transfusion. If there is no agglutination, so we can happening between the donor's RBCs and the plasma or serum of the recipient, so we can continue blood transfusion. But also not to forget to make reverse of cross matching by testing the recipient's red blood cells with the serum of the donor. And if there is no, this is because we have many other antigenic systems other than ABO. So for to prevent any reaction, so also after making the cross matching, we can test the reverse of cross matching with the red blood cells of the recipient with the plasma of or serum of the donor. And if there is no agglutination occur, so blood transfusion can continue without. So the first cause for studying of ABO system or blood grouping actually is it is important in blood transfusion. A second cause also that it is important for medical legal use in disputed paternity. And this is what we call when a mother or a female or a woman bring a baby, and then she tell us that this baby is the son of this man. So how to prove this, and the man is denying. So how to prove this, or how to exclude it. So كيف نثبت البنوة أو كيف ننفيها. For example, if the mother is blood group AB and the child is blood group O, so now the mother having blood group A, if she is having blood group A, so this blood group A either to be AA or AO. So if the blood group A is AA, so the child can have a dominant gene A. If the mother is having blood group B and either to be BB or BO, so the child must have B or O. So if the child is having also can get this O gene from his mother. But if the father is blood group AB, so the father now is having two dominant antigens, A or B. In such conditions, the fetus also must have A or B gene, dominant genes. But if the baby is O, not having A or B genes, in such condition we can say that this baby is not coming from this man, and this man is innocent from this disputed paternity. Now we are going to another antigenic system which is around together with the ABO system, what we call Rh system or D factor of blood grouping. This factor or antigen is present also on the outer surface of the red blood cells together with the A and B antigen. So and this antigen actually was first discovered in the blood of rhesus monkey, and we found that also this antigen is around in the blood of the human. The most common Rh antigen around in the human is the D antigen. We have many Rh antigen, but the most famous of them is the D antigen. This D antigen is around in 85% of population, and we call them Rh positive, and the other 15% which D antigen is not around in their on their red blood cells, we call them Rh negative. Unlike the ABO system, the D antigen is not around, is not having corresponding natural agglutinin, is not having anti-D antibody. This is different from the ABO system. The ABO system having its corresponding antibodies, but the D antigen naturally not having the corresponding antibody. But if Rh positive red blood cells is transfused into Rh negative person, this will lead to sensitization of the immune system, and in such conditions the immune system start in the Rh negative person start to form anti-D antibodies or anti-D agglutinins. But naturally, the Rh antigen or D antigen not having corresponding antibodies. So the Rh negative individual naturally not having anti-D antibodies. This Rh antigen or D antigen also, unlike the BO system, is not around on other tissues of the body or in body secretions. The Rh factor is an inherited, it is dominant factor. So meaning that both genes are capital D, are D and D, D and D capital, both of them are capital D. While of it is one capital D and one small D, we can call it heterozygous. In the first condition, if they are both genes are D capital, are dominant genes, so they are homozygous. While if the Rh positive is one dominant and one recessive, one capital D and one small d, in such condition we call it heterozygous Rh positive individual. And Rh negative actually is around with complete absence of dominant D antigen or with homozygous of small d, the two small d antigens, which are two small genes which are recessive genes. So the genotype, so the Rh negative individual either to be not having dominant capital D genes or to be having homozygous small d recessive genotype or genes. What is the importance of Rh factor? We actually the Rh factor is important in two conditions: in blood transfusion, and in another, the second condition is what we call erythroblastosis fetalis. So the first condition, if there is an Rh negative individual transfused with Rh positive blood, so in such condition the immune system of the Rh negative individual will be sensitized, and anti-Rh agglutinins or anti-Rh antibodies will start to appear within 3 to 4 weeks. And these reactions and appearance of agglutinins in the Rh negative, in the blood of the Rh negative individual, we call it delayed transfusion reaction. After 3 to 4 months, the level of anti-Rh agglutinins reach a high level, and in this person his immune system is sensitized by Rh agglutinogens, if this person received Rh positive blood again, a rapid agglutination will happen, and this will lead to rapid hemolysis of red blood cells, of transfused red blood cells, and what we call immediate transfusion reaction. So what about the erythroblastosis fetalis? Actually, this condition happens when a negative Rh negative female is married from Rh positive male. In such condition, mostly the fetus will be Rh positive. 85% of incidence will be a positive baby. So the first time of delivery, during the first time of delivery, some of fetal red blood cells during removal of the placenta and during delivery will pass. So in such condition there is detachment of the blood vessels and from between the fetus and the mother, and some of the red blood cells of the fetus will pass through the circulation of the mother, and in such condition these Rh positive red blood cells having Rh antigen will lead to sensitization of the immune system of the negative of the Rh negative mother. So the first baby will pass without any problems, but the problems will happen with the second baby. In such with the second pregnancy, now the mother having anti-RH agglutinins in her circulation, and 80%, 85% of the instance the baby will be RH positive. So the anti-RH and agglutinins are of the type of immune G, immune G gamma globulins, which are smaller in molecular weight and molecular size and can pass through the placental barrier. So in such condition, the antibodies will pass through the placenta to the circulation of the baby, and agglutination or reaction will happen, and this reaction will lead to hemolysis of the red blood cells of the baby. This will lead to what we call hemolytic anemia and jaundice. This condition, hemolytic anemia and jaundice, we call them erythroblastosis fetalis. And due to the hemolysis of severe hemolysis of the red blood cells, this can lead to increased bilirubin in the circulation, and this bilirubin can pass to the brain. This will lead to damage of the basal ganglia of the fetus, and this will result in serious motor disturbances, a condition what we call it Kernicterus. And actually in severe cases, these reactions can lead to intrauterine fetal death, intrauterine or death of the fetus inside the uterus. How to prevent and treat erythroblastosis fetalis? First of all, RH negative female should never transfuse with RH positive blood. And if it is possible not to make her to marry RH positive male, it will be okay. But if it happened, so in such condition, after the first pregnancy, after rapidly after delivery, we can inject her with anti-RH antibodies. So these RH antibodies, when go to the mother circulation, will damage the red blood cells coming from the fetus and prevent them from immunization, from stimulation of the immune system of the mother. And about the third step for the fetus, for the second fetus, we can, if it is born alive, so we can make what we call repeated exchange transfusion of the baby's blood with RH negative blood. So we withdraw some of the baby's blood and substitute this blood with transfusion by RH negative blood. So now we are going to blood transfusion, and what are the indications of blood transfusion? So blood transfusion actually is blood transfusion is indicated actually in three conditions: either restoration of the whole blood, for example during hemorrhage, or to restore one of the deficient elements of the blood, like in hemophilia, where there is some deficiency or of coagulation factor. So we can restore this deficient element of blood by blood transfusion. So number one is restoration of the whole blood, like in hemorrhage, how to restore one of the elements of blood, either to be red blood cells, white blood cells, the platelets, so what is deficient, or some coagulation factors. And as we mentioned before, the third indication for blood transfusion is erythroblastosis fetalis with RH negative blood. So what are the precautions of blood transfusion? So during blood transfusion, there is some precautions must be taken in consideration. Actually there is. So number one, so the donor from which we shall take this blood actually must be healthy, without any diseases, any infective diseases, so like AIDS and syphilis and hepatitis and CN. So number one, the donor must be healthy. Okay, number two, the blood must be compatible by cross matching and reverse of cross matching. Number three, also RH compatibility must be confirmed and tested, not to transfuse RH negative blood into Rh positive, Rh positive blood, so not to transfuse Rh positive blood into Rh negative individual. Also, hemoglobin content must be high, not to transfuse blood with low hemoglobin. So what is the benefit in such condition? So number four is must the hemoglobin must be high. Also, the blood must not be stored for more than 3 or 4 weeks. Not to be stored more than 3 or 4 weeks at 4 degrees centigrade. Actually, it is better to make blood transfusion with fresh blood. Also, number six, the temperature of the blood to be transfused must be similar to the body temperature, so not to produce any other reactions because of the difference in temperature between the blood and the body temperature. Also, the blood transfusion must be slow, not to be rapid, because rapid blood transfusion will lead to increased load on the heart and increased load in the circulation, and this will lead to serious complications on the heart. So we but we have some hazards in blood transfusion. Also, blood transfusion can be beneficial in certain conditions, what we mentioned before, this indicated for blood transfusion, but also the blood transfusion has its hazards. Number one of these hazards actually results from transfusion of incompatible blood. If with due to any wrong or any mistakes we transfuse incompatible blood, so if we have a patient with blood group B and mistakenly we transfused him with a blood group A, so this will lead to agglutination of the donor's red blood cells with the recipient antibody. This will lead to agglutination of red blood cells and the clumping and the aggregations of these blood, of these red blood cells, sticking of these blood cells together, what we call clumps or aggregation or agglutination, sorry, agglutination. And this agglutination means the clumping of blood cells or sticking of blood cells together. This can lead to block of capillaries in chest or anywhere in the body, and this will result in severe pain in different parts of the body. Also, severe hemolysis or severe reaction can lead to hemolysis of the red blood cells, and this hemolysis of the red blood cells actually will lead to release. We are aware that red blood cells are containing inside it or are rich by hemoglobin, rich by histamine, and rich with potassium cations. So if there is release after hemolysis, if there is a release of histamine produces generalized vasodilatation. This generalized vasodilatation will lead to severe decrease in the arterial blood pressure and shock. Also, release of potassium from the red blood cells will lead to hyperkalemia, and this hyperkalemia will lead to cardiac arrhythmia and sometimes stop of the heart during diastole. Hemoglobin released from the red blood cells, this will lead to increased formation of bilirubin, and this will result in hemolytic jaundice, and also can lead to formation of acid hematine, which is precipitated and in the renal tubules and leading to block of the renal tubules and renal failure. And also the released hemoglobin can lead to increased viscosity, and this increased viscosity will lead to increased peripheral resistance and increased load on the heart, and this will lead to heart failure. Also, we have from the complications also of incompatible blood transfusion. This is about detach of some of emboli, and this can block any capillaries anywhere and produce something what we call air or fat embolism. Also, infection. So if there is infection, if the blood is if the donor's blood is having viruses or of hepatitis or AIDS, so or the malaria, so this infection can be transfused with blood and affect the recipient. Also, blood transfusion must not be excessive, because excessive blood transfusion will lead to overload of the circulation and overload in the heart, and this will lead to heart failure. As we are aware, the blood is prevented from coagulation by adding citrate to the blood. And if there is excess blood transfusion, so this will contain excess citrate, and this excess citrate will lead to precipitation of ionized calcium. In such condition, we shall suffer, or the recipient will suffer from hypocalcemia. The final point in this lecture is what we call autologous blood transfusion. So to avoid and protect the recipient from the hazards of blood transfusion, if there is somebody is going to perform any surgical procedures, any surgery, so sometime 1 month before the surgery, we feed him with a very good diet with vitamins and iron and so on. Then every week we can withdraw from him about 500 cubic centimeters of blood and 500 milli of blood. So over 3 weeks we can withdraw about from 1.5 liter of blood. And during surgery, if he is in need for blood transfusion, so we can transfuse him with his own blood, what we call autologous blood transfusion. This will protect him from any reactions to happen. Thank you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.